Next then, in our look at solid code principles, and this time we're going to be looking at the O, which stands for the open-close principle, which is normally formulated as classes should be open to extension but closed to modification, or in more general terms, that when we add new features to a system, we should do that by adding new classes, not by modifying existing classes, not by modifying existing code. And when I'm teaching this in front of a class, I normally introduce it by asking the class whether they've ever been asked to add a new feature to an existing application. And of course, everybody, including myself, says yes. And so I then ask them whether they successfully added that new feature. And again, everybody, including myself, says yes. And then I ask them whether, while adding that new feature, they accidentally broke some existing feature. And once again, everybody, including myself, says yes. Because when you're adding new features, you're focusing on that part of the job, and you're not necessarily concentrating on, or indeed you may not even completely understand, the other things that the code is doing. And so with the open-close principle, we're saying never tamper with existing code, certainly not if it's working code. Always try to add new features by adding new classes. Personally, I think that the open-close principle is actually probably the overarching of the five solid code principles, and that all of the other four, in some way or another, are maybe specific examples of what the open-close principle is trying to get us to do. So, for example, with the single responsibility principle, the idea that a class should only do one job, what tends to happen is that when a class is initially written, it only does one job, and then as time goes by, you try to add new jobs to the same class because you're breaching the open-close principle that says you should add new classes, not modify the existing classes. And in fact, another way we can look at the open-close principle is to take it one step further than the single responsibility principle. Remember, the single responsibility principle says that a class should have only one reason for change, whereas the open-close principle actually says a class should have zero reasons for change. We don't change classes, we add new classes when we want to add new features. So let's take a look at that in a practical situation. And what we've got here is the same rock, paper, scissors game that I was showing you in the video on the single responsibility principle. And so in that example, what I'd done was split up the game class, which managed the two players and the way the game's played. And previously, it also had what I've now moved into this signs class, where it had the enum and it also had the matrix for doing the calculation. So that is what we dealt with last time. And now I'm going to take a look at another one of the classes here, the player class. And if we take a look at this, we should be able to see fairly quickly, again, it's got a breach of the single responsibility principle, in that it's got the responsibility for storing things like the name and the score and that sort of thing. But it's also got the responsibility of determining what is going to be thrown. It determines the tactics that the player is going to play. So here, just a random number to choose rock, paper, or scissors. But one place we might decide we're going to vary this application is to actually have different tactics for the way that we play. Now, in fact, probably just a random choice out of three is probably the best way to play rock, paper, scissors, but you could have other ones as well. So let's say somebody wanted to play with the approach that they'll go random, but they will never repeat themselves. So if they did rock one time, it's either going to be paper or scissors the next time. Now, what we don't want to do, because it breaches both the SRP and the OCP, is just dive in here and start changing the code. On the other hand, something we must always remember about the open-close principle is it doesn't just happen by magic. You can't take any old piece of code and apply to it the idea that you're only going to add new classes. The existing code must be in a suitable state. And so we're going to have to make a few changes, but they're going to be refactorings, in essence, to get us to a better state that we can be in. So what I'm going to do is here, I'm going to add a new class. So we'll add a new class, and I'm going to call this non-repeating player. And then we'll derive that non-repeating player from player. And then the immediate thing you'll notice is it doesn't like our constructor. So the first thing we'll have to do is put a constructor in there. And if we look at the original player, we can see the constructor just takes the name. So we'll change that. We'll put string name in there and then just pop that down to the base class. So that's made that happy. And then we want to change the behavior of our throw. So the obvious thing to do here when we've got a derived class, we're going to have to make that into a virtual method. So that's the first thing we've had to do to modify. It's not a serious modification, but it is some change to the existing code that we've got to have as a compromise when we're first starting with the open-close principle. And then what we'll do in here then is we'll override that. And then remember the idea here, we're not going to repeat ourselves. What that means is we're going to have to remember the last thing that we threw. So in here, if we say private sign, and let's make this a nullable type, and then underscore last sign. And then in our throw, we can say if last sign equals null. So if this is the very first time we've played, then we're simply going to call the base class throw method, but then we're going to put the result of that, which you'll remember is stored in the sign property of the base class, we're going to put that in there. So we're throwing it, generating it purely randomly, and putting that into sign. And then, once we've thrown at least once, what we need to do is here, we're going to steal a bit of code from the base class and put that in there, but we're going to have a local variable called sign with a lowercase s, and rather than choosing it completely randomly from the three, we're just going to choose out of the first two. And then we can say if sign equals last sign, then that means we've got the repetition. So instead, we'll say sign equals, cast it to sign, and then 2. So what that means is that we choose randomly from the first two, rock or paper, and if it happens to come out to be the one we did last time around, then we say it's definitely going to be scissors. So that's the algorithm that will mean that we just get randomly, but without repeating ourselves. And then the last thing we've got to do is we've got to say underscore last sign equals sign with a lowercase s, so that we're just taking that and setting it as our current one and also remembering it as our previous one. But you can see we've still got a couple of problems there in our random and our sign property. And we can see that if we look at the player base class, the reason we're getting that is because the setter on the sign is private, and we're trying to set it, so we need to make that protected. And also the random number generator is private, so we need to make that protected as well. And then back in here, that's now going to be working okay. And then the last thing to do to test all that, we've got to, in the program, let's just change Harry to a non-repeating player, so leave Sally as a regular player. And then if we run that up, and then have a look at that, we don't need to do too in-depth analysis, but believe me, we'll see that Harry is never repeating himself, whereas Sally may be repeating herself sometimes. So that's one way to introduce that. And although we did need to make some changes to the existing code, to the player base class, it was just to set it up on the correct footing. So there we've seen one way of implementing the open-close principle. But one of the things to be a little bit wary of is the terminology that says a class should be open to extension. Because extension can make people think we're talking about what I've done here, which is using inheritance. Because certainly if you're a Java programmer or a JavaScript programmer, then actually the extends keyword is what marks inheritance. But in the open-close principle, we're not talking about that, or we're not solely talking about that. There are other ways that we can do extension as well. And often there are rather better ones. One way that we can do it is actually to use a fairly well-known design pattern, which is a thing called a strategy pattern. And the strategy pattern is absolutely ideal for situations like this, because actually, in this case, we are literally talking about a strategy, the strategy that you use to play the game Rock, Paper, Scissors. In other circumstances, you might still use the strategy pattern where it's less obviously a strategy because you're not in a gaming environment, but it's still the same thing. So what I'm going to do is add to this an interface. So let's put that in. And I'm going to call this IRPS strategy, RPS for Rock, Paper, Scissors. And then in the interface, I'm just going to put the method that we're essentially trying to extract from the player. So it's going to be returning our sign, and it's going to be called throw. And then we want to introduce our two possible implementations, so the random and the random non-repeating. So I will now add a new class called random strategy. And we will make that implement our strategy, generate the code, and then I will nick from our player the actual random code we've got there, put that in there, and just say return that. And so that's now our random strategy. But then we can immediately notice we've got a slight problem there, that the random number generation isn't available. Again, think in terms of the single responsibility principle. Well, if a player isn't actually going to be generating the sign it's throwing, then it doesn't need the random number generator. So actually, I'm going to take that and I'm going to pop that into, well, not into our strategy class. Nice new feature that came in C Sharp 8, I think, is we can actually put static members into interfaces. Because although interfaces aren't allowed to have instance members, they are actually allowed static members. And so now if we put that in there, we can go to our specific strategy, and just one slight difference, we can't call it directly, just like with any static member, we have to call it on the class, and so now we can see that we've got that accessible. And so that's our random strategy. And then let's also introduce our non-repeating strategy. So again, add another class. And I'm going to steal a lot of that code. Except in here, we can actually take the code from the non-repeating player. So if we take that private field and now put that into the strategy, and then take the actual implementation here and put that into the throw. And then we've only got a few little problems here. Obviously, we can't have a base.throw because we don't have a base class here. So what I will do there is actually just steal that code. So we're going to say last sign equals the random 3, and then we're going to say return last sign. Thing to watch out for, last sign is nullable, so we're going to have to say dot value on there. And then similarly here, remember we've got to change that one to irps strategy dot random, and then here we're going to say last sign equals sign, and then again return last sign to value. In fact, I don't like that repetition, so I'm going to do here, just at the end of it, I'm going to say return last sign dot value, and then we don't have to have it in two places. So that's all happy. So we've now introduced our two strategies. In terms of actual code, nothing different at all about them. We've copied one from the player and the other from the non-repeating player, but we can see that we're now obeying not only the open-close principle, but also the single responsibility principle, in that each of these strategies just does its one bit of the job. Now all we need to do is go back to our player and get the player to have a strategy. So what we can do is we'll give the player a private IRPS strategy called strategy. We will add a parameter to the constructor so that when we create a player, they get their strategy created. So as well as having name equals name. And then in the throw, well, bear in mind, that's not going to be virtual anymore. And indeed, we can set that back to private because we're not using the inheritance approach. The throw is simply going to say sign equals underscore strategy dot throw. And so whatever strategy we've passed in of the two or however many we're adding, it will be the one that's used there. Then we can do the fun bit, which is deleting code. So we don't need now to have the non-repeating player. We've now just got the one kind of player and as many strategies as we like. So we'll delete that. And then finally, in the program, we will need to now, whenever we create a player, we need to give them a strategy. So we're going to make Sally a new random strategy. And then we'll give Harry a new non-repeating strategy. And then the gameplay should be exactly as it was before. So again, I'll leave you to do the analysis, but we should find that Sally is sometimes repeating, whereas Harry never repeats because he's got that different strategy. So there we have it. Two ways that we can implement the open-close principle. One of them taking perhaps that word extends a bit literally and doing it with inheritance, so we had a derived class, and the other one by doing it with an interface. A third way you could do it, which might have worked here, is actually you can do it with delegates. So we could have made our player, rather than taking an object of that strategy interface, we could have just taken in a delegate, and then the delegate could have done either the random out of three or the non-repeating random. So there's various ways of doing it, but the key thing is now, whenever we come up with a new strategy, we don't need to change the player code, we simply need to write a new strategy and plug that in. And that ties in with a number of the other solid principles. So we've talked about how it makes sense in terms of the single responsibility principle. We'll be talking later on about the dependency inversion principle, which will help us to get the correct strategy into the correct place. It's also worth mentioning this in terms of the next principle we're going to look at, which is the Liskov substitution principle, because that will help us determine which of those two approaches is best. Here, I would say I'd use the strategy pattern with the interface. The problem being, we saw when we did the derived class that there was quite a lot of extra work we had to do. We had to make things protected rather than private. We had to give the derived class a new constructor so that it could pass the data down to the base class. And fundamentally, I think, we've got to question whether there is such a thing as a non-repeating player, because it's not really the case that you have different players of entirely different types, one a repeating player, one a non-repeating player. Any particular player might change their strategy midway through their lifetime, and so having the strategy as a separate object that you pass in is a better way to go. So we've moved on. We've done S, the single responsibility principle. That was O, the open-close principle. Next time it's going to be L, the Liskov substitution principle. But I hope you enjoyed that, and if you did, do subscribe to the channel so you won't miss any future updates.